find grace. Come on now. Bet your woman sing hallelujah. Bet you say it, amen. Well, good evening. How are you guys doing tonight? I'm glad to see you guys here today. It's good to see such a large group. And after Pastor John's message on Sunday, he gave you guys all the statistics on mental health and all those things. And for us to do a mental health discussion is because Freshwater is all about bringing life and bringing Jesus into all the parts of our life. And our mental health is really important. So if you're not struggling with mental health, probably a person sitting next to you is, or somebody in your family is, or you will at some point. So this information is going to be really good for you to get. And we're going to have a lot of ministry. We have a great team of people who are coming with lots more knowledge than I have, or Pastor John has. They've been educated, and they minister in this area all the time. And so we're really fortunate. I want to invite Jody up. Jody Goldie, come on up. I promised I wouldn't embarrass her with all of her credentials and all of those things, but I want to tell you, she's well-credentialed. She's an amazing amazing woman for Jesus, and she also ministers in the mental health field on a regular basis, and she's got lots of great information for us tonight, and she's got her team of ladies that she ministers with. So I'm just going to pray for you guys before we start, and for the rest of us, for God to just meet us here right now. Father God, I thank you for Freshwater, and I thank you for Jody and Ellie and Christine, and I thank you for their ability to come and minister with us today, God, and that they will bring the knowledge that you've given them and the gifts that you've given them to really hit our hearts today with the message that you have for us. I thank you, God, that this is a place where we can be safe and honest about what's going on with us because you're here, and I ask for your Holy Spirit to just be in our hearts today, God, to soften us in the areas that we need to hear something new and different and encourage us that there's hope because we hope in you. We thank you for being here with us today, and we ask for your will to be done as we hear all of this stuff, God. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. And I'm going to hand it over to you, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having us here. My name is Jody Goldie, and I am a licensed marriage and family therapist. Actually, before I begin, so we are here talking about mental health, and Pastor Anna reached out to me and was just like, hey, this is what we're looking for. And I was like, I could really do it, but I actually have a lot of holes that I need filled. And I asked my two friends to come because I'm really good at helping people understand their brain and what's going on in some of their body. But what I'm missing is some of the body stuff. And so Ellie's going to come help me with that. And then I wanted somebody to come and work with your church around partnering with the Holy Spirit and how to integrate some of this in our inner spirits. And so Christine, who is a prayer minister, is here to help us with that. And so Ellie is a trauma specialist, really body-based somatic worker. So we're going to do that tonight. So tonight, I'm going to start by asking Ellie to come up, and she's going to kind of like help us kind of be here in this space, and then I'll come up and talk for a little bit.
Thank you. All right, so I know today we're going to be talking a little bit about anxiety, and I'm sure all of us have experienced it. Even being here on stage, like some people love it, other people, anxiety. And so anxiety is a lot of in our head. And I would love to just start with a little practice, a tool for you guys to take home that I use very often with my clients and myself. Just a quick thing to get out of our head and slowly integrate into our body. And so I'm going to invite you guys to either start with closing your eyes or lowering your gaze. Whatever feels comfortable, just getting focused so that you can really come back to your breath. Just noticing your breath as you breathe in through your nose and out, knowing there's no right or wrong way of doing this. You can go as fast or as slow as you'd like. You can set the pace and the rhythm. Just noticing how your chest expands with each in-breath. Maybe noticing the sides of your chest with the next inhale, how it grows and expands. Just And now just focusing on relaxing your abdomen a little bit, allowing that breath to go a little bit deeper. And just getting mindful of any sensations that you may be feeling at the front of the chest, maybe the front of your heart. Maybe there's some tingling, some pulsing. You can feel your heartbeat. And again, noticing the sides of your chest, the sides of your heart, as it expands and contracts with every in-breath and out-breath. And just moving your breath to the back of the heart, maybe leaning a little bit more into your chair, feeling the space between the back of your heart and the chair or the nearest wall behind you. Picking up on any sensations or feelings there. Allowing maybe your shoulders to drop, to sit a little deeper in your chair. And if you notice your mind wandering, just gently bringing it back without any judgment, refocusing on that breath. And if you again drop into your body, just notice what you're feeling right now. Maybe you feel lighter. Maybe you feel more ease. Maybe there's some tension. Taking a few more breaths and slowly orienting yourself back to the room. Maybe bringing some movement to gently wake up the body. You can wiggle your toes or your fingers. Maybe rub your thighs a little bit, gently up and down, going at your own pace. Moving your neck from side to side, whatever feels good for you. And then when you're ready, at your own pace, you can gently open your eyes and get some light in. Did anybody feel any difference with that? So again, that's just a very simple way to kind of drop out of your head, get back to your body. We did a couple of different things where you can either focus on the breath, you can focus on sensations, you can focus on your heart space, but it's just a way for us to feel back in our body. This is what it feels like to be present. This is what it feels like to have joy when we're actually fully engaged and our body is here with us and we're not so stuck in our head with anxiety or looping thoughts. And so I'm going to hand it over to Jody. She's going to talk a little bit more about what that looks like, and then we'll get back on and do a couple more exercises. All right.
Thanks, Ellie. Oh, I'm going to give this to you. I'm scared of it. Oh, that's, yeah. I'm like, I don't want that. I probably, so my name is Jody. We've established that. In my work life, I am a complex trauma therapist, which means that I work with people who have experienced trauma throughout their lifespan and have had it from like birth to, you know, to wherever they are in many different ways. But in my real life, I live at home in the woods with my husband and my two teenage boys and my very large dog, and we just try to stay, you know, in the woods, basically, in order to stay regulated. And that's what I love. I love to be out in nature. It's the thing that, like, helps me the most. This is what I'm talking about today, is your brain a safe place to live? Like, if you would have, if past me from 5 years ago would have been watching me right now and seeing that slide, I would have been like, what is wrong with you? That's insane. Or even sitting through an exercise like Ellie just led, because I have spent so much of my life outside of my body.
in order to survive and in order to regulate and in order to take care of myself. So like a life of trauma and then trying to figure out how to deal with it. And so my brain was like, it was kind of like an evil overlord. It was really mean from the time that I would open my eyes to the time that I would do anything. It was constantly like, you're so stupid. Why did you say that? You can't do this. It's constantly talking me out of who I am, right? And so the other day I was in therapy, because never trust a therapist that doesn't go to therapy, by the way. We all need it, right? We all need to do our work and we all have issues. But my therapist asked me, so what, right now, what is the safest place in your body? And I was like shocked and like everything went on in my brain because I was like, I can't believe this, but right now, like the safest place in my body is my brain. It's like this sweet place because for the last 5 years I've been on a journey of figuring out how to make it a safe place because I was exhausted from living with it for so long. So that's why I want to kind of talk to you guys about today. And a lot of this comes from another woman that I dearly love. Her name is Sarah Payton. And she does a lot of, she gathers all the research, which is kind of what I do too, and she puts it into things. So she wrote this beautiful book called Your Resonant Self. And she's not a believer. She's a scientist that gathers information. So like always read things with a grain of sand and just think through it from your spiritual lens. But she has incredible information about how to soften some of that. So I wanted to kind of talk about some of the things that I've learned, that she's shared, that I've picked up from other places. So first of all, in brain science, because that's like what I dearly, dearly love. Like for me, if I can make sense of something and if I can say, oh, that makes sense because of X, Y, Z in our brains, et cetera, then it builds compassion. I don't feel so crazy. I've found that the craziest things that have ever happened or the way that I've responded makes sense. I was actually just sitting with a good friend of mine, a girl, good friend of my daughter, who experienced a significant traumatic event over the weekend. And she started out like just very numb and really scared to talk to me. And I was like, I don't know how to get this 11-year-old to talk to me because nobody wants to talk about this stuff. And actually it's best if we don't sometimes, just because it can re-imprint some of that trauma. So I just started asking her, did you react in a way that was really scary for you, that didn't make sense to you or that was confusing? And she was like, I froze. I didn't help him. And it was like, why did I do that? Why? And so I was like, oh, that makes sense. And so we just started talking about all the ways the body makes sense and how she reacted. And that was super fun to watch her like light up and actually kind of release some of that stuff. So that's kind of some of the stuff I want to do today. So first slide here. There is this thing in brain science called network theory. I don't know if you've ever heard of this, but we used to think that there was like one part of the brain that would light up when you like listened and one part of the brain that would light up when you were giving a speech or something like that. And then we started to learn when we got the fMRI scans where we could actually put people in brain scans. And we actually started to notice that like there were so many parts of the brain that lit up with all the different tasks that we did. And so there's all these different networks that happen. And so they put people in the scanner and then they were like watching what the networks were to actually notice like what lights up and what, you know, when they do this. And so the guy who's like running the fMRI scanner puts the guy in the, you know, scanner machine. And he's probably like eating or having his coffee or whatever, and notices, wait a second, the scanner is going crazy. And the person's just sitting in the scanner and they're not doing anything. And they were like, what is happening? And they decided, they were like, this is the resting state. And I like put it in quotes, it's a resting state because your brain is actually more active when you're in a resting state than when you're doing any other task. More things are online. And so they all got together, all these scientists, and they were like, we got to come up with the best name for this network in the brain. And so they decided to call it the default mode network. I seriously feel like if they would have asked their mom, they probably would have come up with a better name. But they're scientists, and this is what happens when scientists name stuff. So this is the default mode network, and that's what I'm going to say over and over, and it's super annoying. But it's our resting state. okay? It is the thing that is at play, like, right before we go to sleep or right when we wake up. It's that like liminal space where we think nothing's happening, where we think our brain is not doing anything. It's actually doing so much. Next slide. So what this basically does is the default mode network, it is a way of the whole time it is, like when we are resting, it is scanning all of our relationships, which is crazy. Like our resting state, what our brain is thinking about constantly is our relationships. So it's saying things like, oh my gosh, that conversation, I shouldn't have said that. Or I really need to reach out to her. Or I wonder what is happening over there. Or da da da. And it's trying to figure out your place and social standing in relationship the whole time. Like that's what rest is. Or like that's what our resting state is trying to do. And it's trying to also understand new experiences so that when I'm sitting with somebody and they're telling me their life story and I'm trying to make sense of it, I can, now that I know what this is, I can feel my default mode network working really hard if they're telling me a story about their experience in life with their farm, say. And I am going through all of my categories in my brain trying to find a category that understands farming. And what can I click it to in my own brain and or somebody that I know or something like that? And that's what it's doing constantly. It's trying to find categories. And you can feel this. When somebody understands and can find categories and can say, yeah, I totally understand that. I had a friend who did this. And so, and then you feel more like resonated with and you feel more connected to them. And that's our default mode. It's constantly doing that in order to connect with people, which is so cool. It is also our creative. So what happens is the default mode takes everything it's ever known and it like jumbles that up and it creates something new out of it. And something new just kind of looks like the same recycled stuff, but it is new. And the great thing about that is because as we get older and older and our experiences grow and grow, we actually get more and more creative, which is a really good sign. Actually, people who are like elderly are actually in their most creative stages, which is awesome. I feel like we need to tap into that more. But the hard thing is, if all you've known throughout your entire life is trauma, what you create is going to be, not that you're creating trauma, but that's what your brain knows to expect. And so oftentimes they say that dreams are in the default mode network, that that's, you know, this is the ultimate resting state, is a dream state. And so a lot of people have nightmares. Well, that makes sense to me, right? Because it's taking what it knows and creating something out of it. Does that make sense? Yeah. And so it can be really tricky because this brain network comes online right in the morning. And so the first thing that you open your eyes and you've known a difficult, you know, traumatic, stressful existence for your life, the first thing that comes online is this default mode creating new experiences. You should be scared of this. What if he does this? What about this? Blah, 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 blah. And it can be exhausting. So how do we experience it? Look at me with my reading glasses. I can't even read my own notes. Gosh. Okay. So take a moment and kind of like if you feel comfortable closing your eyes, but you don't have to, just kind of notice. Like, what do you think about when you're in the shower? That is such a creative time for me. I get the best ideas in the shower. And that's your default mode. What is your first thought in the morning? Or what does it feel like when you wake up? What do you think about when you're in your car, just driving, and you're like, you know that just like road zone out thing? Like what's going on in you when that's happening? What do you think about before you fall asleep? A lot of people have a really hard time kind of drifting into sleep because a lot of times we're rehearsing conversations that we've had that are really hard or good. What do you think about when you're on vacation? This is one that I'm actually working on in my personal life, so that vacations are good, because vacations, this is when it's most active, and I get really, like, irritable during vacations, even though I'm supposed to be at rest, but when I'm at rest, that's when that kicks in, and some of those old messaging comes online. if that makes sense. So what did you notice? How did your brain speak to you? Is it harsh? Is it good and positive? Next slide. So when, where'd Troy go? Next slide, whenever you're ready. So when I'm in a good place, and I don't like, oh, next one, sorry. And I, oh, next one, that's my husband. That was for something else. Isn't he cute though? if your default mode is really, I actually don't like the terms healthy and unhealthy, because I think there's such a continuum, and I struggle with that, because I think sometimes the things that we think are unhealthy are, it's just how we're surviving. It's not always unhealthy. So, but I'm using these words just because I don't know what else to use. But if your default mode is healthy, and if it's like, if it's in the scientist term for this is actually integrated. And integrated means that all of our brain is working together, and our body is working together, and our spirit is working together. And so if it's all integrated, it's amazing. This network is the most beautiful network. It helps us keep all of our social experiences afloat. It reminds us of what to do to actually care for people. So like mine, now that my brain is a healthy place to live, or a safe place to live, like when I'm driving in my car, I'll be like, oh my gosh, Christine has this huge meeting this morning. I should text her and let her know that I'm thinking of her and I'm praying for her. It's the thing that makes me remember things. Oh my gosh, my aunt died. I need to reach out to my cousin. I know he's really hurting. Oh my gosh, you know, all these things, so that it's ordering all my social standing, but in a really helpful way, so that I can be the body, right? So that I can actually uplift the people around me that need the care that they need and receive the care that I need too. It is kind. It has curiosity. And so when things come up, I don't get easily offended or assume that it's because I did X, Y, Z and have shame. But it's like, oh, I wonder what that is about. I should probably talk to them about it. I don't go in those spirals. Don't worry, that still happens. But like I can calm it, and we can talk about that a little bit later. And it is gracious with myself and with other people. And if it's... harsh. So I'll go to the next slide. If it's really harsh, and I feel like people resonate more with this one, to be honest, because I think it's I feel like for some reason our default mode, the default isn't to be kind, because a lot of the time what the default mode is it's taking all the voices that we've ever had in our lives, and it's speaking to us through those voices. And so oftentimes people have harsh default modes because they've had really harsh voices in their lives that have spoken to them all their lives. And so it makes sense, right? We kind of keep perpetuating what we know and what we've experienced in our lives. So if it is harsh, your brain has negative thoughts when it tries to rest. It kind of does that self-blaming, like, why did you do that? Why did you say that? That was so dumb. When you were on stage, I know I'll probably do this tonight. When you were on stage, you said that, and somebody in the crowd was probably hurt by that. And just like all those little, Sarah Payton calls it a knife in the darkness. They just come out of nowhere, and they stab you, and you're like, I don't even know where that's coming from. It's discrediting, blaming, attacking, invalidating, contemptuous. I'm like seeing nods. I'm like, are you guys okay? And then there's these like overwhelming emotions that just come out of nowhere, and they're totally unnamed. There are times when I get like spikes of terror in my body that I'm like, what is that about? And it's usually about my brain, my default mode is trying to tell me that I've done something wrong. And I've messed it all up, right? I mean, these are all the tapes that we keep playing in our heads over and over. So having a harsh default mode, what it leads to is anxiety. That one keeps coming up. And I know that like I recorded a podcast with Pastor Anna and Pastor John, and we talked a lot about anxiety. But anxiety actually is really hard to name in our body. Like it's really hard to make sense of because it runs on two neural networks. And I can talk about this when I get to another slide. But it runs on fear, which makes sense, right? But it also runs on another one called panic or separation grief. But a lot of people really appreciate the words alarmed aloneness. And it's just that feeling that I'm out of connection and I don't know how to get in connection. And that occurs a lot with our default mode, because remember, it's always trying to figure out connection with people. And so a lot of times we feel like we've messed up the connection, we can't get it back, and it leads to a lot of panic in our body. And that's anxiety. Does that make sense? It's kind of a helpful way to think about it. It can lead to depression. A lot of times depression feels like a frozen state that we can't mobilize, we can't get out of, because it just hurts too bad. Exhaustion, obviously. If you have somebody yelling at you all the time, you're going to be exhausted. Compromised immune system. They've done all these great studies on contempt. If you live with somebody who has contempt, which means just somebody who has disgust for you, basically, that most people get sick for like 3 days, that if you live with somebody who has contempt for you, that your immune system will not heal for 6 days. Because of that voice that keeps coming at you. But this voice is somebody in your own body. It's somebody that you can't get away from. It's in, like, basically you're living with an abuser all the time. And a lot of us don't even notice it, because we don't even notice that there's something wrong, that that voice is not actually what we're supposed to be living with. A lot of times when our default mode is really harsh, we'll do anything to turn it off. Anything. Because remember, it's just a network in your brain, so you can turn it off. So a lot of people have discovered, in order to turn it off, like on their own, they'll turn to video games. TikTok. Don't get me started on TikTok. I love it. It's a problem. And she introduced me to it. She's also helping me get off. texting, you know, Netflix, like binge watching shows and things like that, smoking, pornography, drinking, work, reading, cutting, like all of these things actually turn off that voice in the head, that default mode. It stops it for a moment. The hard thing is then later it comes back, and it might come back bigger, right? I mean, we all know these things help in the moment, and they do help to regulate our bodies a little bit, but then it gets harder later on. It's interesting. I can tell someone's default mode pretty quick. Like when I, and this is from my own experience with myself, if I am sitting with somebody and I, like, say they have like a really great interaction with somebody that they've struggled with for a long time, and I'm like, whoa, you did such a good job. I cannot believe that. That is so much progress. You did so good. And I give them a compliment. If their default mode feels really good and kind of, you know, soft and tender, if you will, they'll be like, thank you. I am really proud of myself. That was really cool. But if their default mode is really harsh, they'll kind of freeze and be like, and I can tell inside they're saying, she has no idea. She has no idea how bad that actually went. She doesn't know the truth about me. It's all of those things that come online, right? And so, because for folks that have known trauma all their life, like the holding like bad experience or holding, if I would have said something like, you're really messing it up, they would be like, yeah, that doesn't hurt, because that's normal. That's what they're hearing all the time in their head. What's really hard is holding positive things, because that's dangerous. You don't know what's coming with positive things. That's different. That's confusing. And so that's part of the work, is how to hold some of that, how hold some of those positive feelings a little bit more in our bodies, because those can signal danger, and that can be really scary. All of these things that are listed up here, when we turn our default mode off, remember default mode's all about relationship, right? And when we turn it off in order to, like, because we have to turn it off, it takes us out of relationship. All of these things takes us out of relationship with others. It takes us out of relationship with God. And it takes us out of relationship with ourselves. all of these things are really numbing things where we live outside of our body. And again, there are things that we need to do sometimes in order to regulate because life is too painful. It's really hard to be in the body sometimes. But I just want you to notice that these are really relational breaking things. So there is this guy named Jak Panskep, and he is like my favorite. He's known as the rat tickler. Why am I talking about this? I don't know. This is a weird segue. He's the father of affective neuroscience, which is like he really wanted to discover the emotions and what was going on in our brain. And so he decided that if I look at the emotions of animals, I think we can understand more about the emotions of humans. And he was absolutely right. What he discovered, I'll show this on the board here. What he discovered was 8 circuits of emotion and motivation. He calls it emotion and motivation. And this is crazy. Like, I don't know if you guys have a dog. I have a dog. My dog has all of these emotions, and I can see them all the time in him. Care, panic, grief, that's that alarmed aloneness. I mean, I used to have a dog with separation anxiety. I thought that was a joke. But he, like, would claw his nails off because he was so panicked that we weren't with him. So this is a very real emotion for dogs and for us. Fear, rage, sexuality, seeking curiosity, play and disgust. All these 8 circuits of emotion, I think they're fabulous. This is super helpful to me to understand what the circuits are. All of these are about relationship. Like our emotions are about relationship. And our thoughts and the default resting mode are about relationship. And this is why I love neuroscience, is because our God, I think his bottom line is that he really cares about relationship. He really, really cares. In fact, he cares about it so much that he made himself 3 so that he could have relationship with himself. To me, that's just crazy. And there's also a relationship between our emotions and our thoughts. And it's big. And you can see this interplay with the default mode network and emotions. So, like, if my default mode is doing really well and I'm having a really good day and I say I do that, I text Christine and she's like, thanks, I really needed that. I feel so seen and heard. I mean, she just praises me all the time. No, I'm just kidding. if that happens, what happens in my emotions, right? I'm like, I did it. Like I feel so positive and so good that I actually like cared for my friend well. And then it also has a relationship in the negative side too. Like recently for the past year, I've had a relationship that I've just not been able to fix. And I feel like I'm coming out of it, but I've spent hours in my default mode trying to fix this relationship, going over conversations in my head, trying to figure out what I did wrong, trying to figure out what I can say to fix it or to make things understand, and I could not figure it out. And so it was like, the emotions would come, and they would be, I'd feel hopeless, and you know, I didn't know what to do. Right? Do we have anybody else who has gone through this with relationships? I see that hand. Thank you. James says, you know, if we need wisdom, just ask. He will give it. And so I was like, Lord, I don't know what to do. And he finally told me, Jody, stop talking to them. Talk to me in your brain. Talk to me. And so anytime I feel that in my default mode, it's a resting state. How are you supposed to change your resting state? It's like, it's on its own rails. But anytime I would notice, it would go there because it feels really good to try to figure it out, but you can't. You just can't figure it out. I would just be like, oh yeah. I would kind of stop and then reorient towards God. And it blew my mind. It was very helpful. So I offer that to you. So when your default mode is harsh, okay, and your emotions are really high, really the toddlers are in charge because your top brain, your adult brain, is not online. when your emotions are that high and when your default mode is hitting you the way it is and you're having that interplay of emotions and pain and things like that, there's nothing you can do because your brain is literally throwing a fit, right? And what do we do with toddlers? I didn't do it that well with toddlers when I had them, but now I know a little bit better. But when a toddler is like going at it on the floor and just having really big emotions, you can't sit there and logic them and reason them and tell them scripture and, you know, pray for them. Like, honestly, like those things, I mean, you can pray for them. That'll probably help too. But there's really nothing you can do other than scoop them up if they'll let you, or sit next to them and just be gentle and wait. Because then when you can scoop them up and wait and just say, I know you're feeling really scared or out of control or whatever it is that you're feeling, we'll just wait. Then it brings it back down. And then you can work with the toddler, right? And so I always say to people, and this is why Ellie is here, get out of your brain and get into your body. When you're in this state, there is nothing you can do with your brain. It's not there. You cannot fix it. You can't make it better. Get out of your brain. Go for a walk. Move your eyes. Start like dancing. Do anything to get out of your brain and into your body. And so I'm going to just talk about like quick a couple of things that I do that have really softened. When the default mode is a little lower, not crazy, and it's like shooting at you in the dark, you know, all the time, this knife in the dark, and when the emotions are lower, these are things that I recommend like working on day to day. Start bravely noticing. I hear people misuse the scripture all the time. And as a therapist, it's really hard for me. I hear people say, take every thought captive and put it into obedience to Christ. And I don't know about you guys, but when people say that, oftentimes what they're saying is, take every thought captive and then put it over here. And if I had a captive who was trying to kill me, like an actual captive, I would not put them over there. I would keep them real close and I would watch them. I would learn all their secrets and I would figure out what the heck they're doing, right? And so when we have thoughts and we're taking them captive, what I'm saying is use your top brain, use your noticing brain. Top brain is like our adult, like all the best skills that we have to really watch. How is this thought talking me out of myself as a daughter or a son of God? Because that's what I notice is that's what these thoughts constantly go after is the image of God in me. That I am a failure, that I am stupid. Like all the things that God has created me to be, they attack that. So take the thought captive and watch it and notice it and learn from it. And then put it in obedience to Christ. Be curious about your resting state. Watch it. Notice it. Have fun with it. Sometimes it's funny noticing what you're actually thinking about. And now that you have a category for it, a little bit more about like relationships, you can kind of watch it and laugh with it. Be kind to yourself. And when I say that, like, we are dearly loved by God. I don't know why, but I haven't... felt dearly loved all the time in my life, but I am dearly loved by God. And so I want my body and my brain to feel dearly loved by me too, and by God, obviously. So, I mean, I think like last night even, or this probably on my way here, that's probably not on my way here with you guys, but before, thinking about like default mode's going crazy. Oh my gosh, you don't know what you're going to talk about. You're going to mess up, right? All the things that happen. And I'm like, brain, it's okay. The Holy Spirit's got us. I know what I'm doing. He always shows up. We're going to be okay. And so like really talking to it, not as you know, something that's trying to be mean to me, but trying to help protect me and being really gentle with it. And I try to talk to my brain a lot, which sounds really weird, but it's actually helped me. And again, ask for wisdom. God loves to give us wisdom. And when I'm stuck with a client, with my own healing, wherever I'm at, I ask for wisdom. And I ask, like, He is the creator of the entire universe. I think he can help me out with this. I think he's already got it, you know? And I think he can work with me on this. So almost like calming myself down enough to remember to ask for wisdom and help is a big thing. So they're doing research into these new substances, like another thing that is really helpful. When our default mode is actually out of control, and it keeps, like, when I was having a really hard time with that relationship that was constantly, like, attacking me in my brain, one thing that we can work on, so they're doing these research on these substances that actually turn your default mode off. And it's great. It's great research. But I'm like, I want to figure out how to do this now. Clearly, there's so many people who can't use substances, and clearly, they're not ready to be used. So what can we do now? And I started scanning all the research, and all the research was telling me what turns off the default mode network is awe. And which is so cool, right? Because awe is another word for worship. Like, it's just like this, oh my word. And so awe is one of those things that can, when things are really high and the toddlers are in charge, awe. So these are three pictures that I took this fall when I was really struggling, because I would go on Easter egg hunts to find awe places, to find little pieces of awe that would surprise me and take me off guard and would throw me out of that default mode network, which was super helpful. So our responsibility around all of this, and especially if your default mode is a little harsh, is a lot of us are harmed in relationship, and a lot of us long to heal in relationship. And it's this really hard relationship, really, of harming. We've been harmed, and we want to heal in relationship. And sometimes people are unsafe. And sometimes God feels really unsafe, too, because we've been told wrong things about him. And so I think sometimes it's been very hard for me to offer warmth or care or softness to areas in my thoughts that have really never experienced that type of care. Like, for the part of me that constantly yells at me, to actually be kind to it feels really weird to me. But then it creates this relationship, right, where it starts being kind to me and it starts softening. So I hope and pray that through knowing this and through observing yourself a little bit more, that maybe God would bless you a little bit more with a little more softness in your brain, that it would be a safe place for you to live. And I'm going to invite Ellie up to kind of get out of our brains and into our bodies.
All right, you guys doing good? Yeah. Okay, so I know Jody talked a lot about integration, so moving from our mind back to our body, back to our spirit, and living holistically. It makes me think of a lot of what Jesus lived like. He was so connected to himself. He was connected to where she was showing the slide, where he was curious, he was kind, he had space for people. Think of a time when you were maybe happy, or even just looking at the screen of those pictures, when there was that calm, serene fall, and how calm your body's felt. Your nervous system relaxed. You could maybe feel yourself sigh a little bit deeper and be a little bit more relaxed. You can sense a little bit more joy. Maybe you even felt the feet or the ground beneath your feet. And you could kind of feel your whole body. You were fully present. You were engaged. And it was easy for you to engage in relationship because that default mode network was not as harsh. And so I kind of want us to walk through how we actually feel that. So Jody mentioned when she's sitting with clients where she can actually feel it turn on. So I want us to experience that first on a very gentle level. So I'm going to ask you guys to go through an activity with me where we can feel that and maybe connect with what are some of the messages. What does that feel like for us? What does it do to our body when we're actually in an exercise where we're kind of monitoring it, maybe from a side? So we're going to do that first, and then I want to bring us back to a place of safety and allow our body to feel safe and feel the opposite of what does it feel like to recenter and get some tools for when that's on. How do we actually kind of not necessarily turn it off, but how do we bring in compassion and kindness so that we make it softer? And we're reacting the way we should with toddlers. We're not yelling and telling them to be quiet and making it worse, because who's done that before? I know I worked at a daycare, and that never worked. You tell them to be quiet, or whenever you do shh, guess what happens? They get so much louder. And so we're gonna teach our systems that too, because very often we learned that from the past. We learned that from trauma, from other voices, from how our parents maybe were not fully consistent, and there's no blame there. But how can we actually reparent our nervous system, the part that connects our body and our brain, so that we have some of those tools and a little bit more tolerance when we are in that uncomfortable state? And so this is a great opportunity if you guys have journals, if you guys are journalers, you can definitely take that out or take notes on your phone. Otherwise, you could just kind of sit through the activity and you'll still remember things because your body has a memory. And so your body, when we do these exercises, will memorize that too. And you can use that as a resource. But I encourage you guys to journal through it or take notes. And then just side tip, journaling is probably the cheapest and best. I'm not going to say the best. It's definitely not the best, but it's a very cheap version of therapy. So if you guys aren't journaling, that's a great way to also just kind of, it's a tool you can use to get out of your head and a little bit more into your body, especially if you ask yourself questions like, what am I feeling like as I'm writing this experience? So just a little side note there. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to just place some parameters here. So when I ask some of these questions, I want to make sure that you're sitting at about 30 to 50% of how much you're feeling. So if we're feeling something uncomfortable, or if I'm going to ask you to kind of sit in some of your anxiety, keep it at a level below 50%. So maybe allow your mind to go somewhere where it's not as intense, because we want to practice and we want to make sure we're not jumping out of what's too uncomfortable and back into our heads. And so keep that in mind. And then if at any point it gets a little too extreme or too loud or too harsh, that's when I'm going to invite you to just gently maybe come back to your breath or take yourself out of the exercise and do something that feels a little bit more connecting. Maybe think of someone who feels loving, a pet, a parent, a person that you feel comfortable and safe with, maybe even a place. Maybe think about the pictures up here with awe and just kind of recenter on that. But we're not going to go super uncomfortable, just to warn you guys. This is actually going to feel really soothing and maybe open a lot of clarity. And so I kind of want you guys to first think about, again, 30 to 50%. When was the last time you had something that brought up that harsh critic? Something where you were replaying a conversation or you were feeling anxiety, you had looping thoughts, you did something and you were uncomfortable. Maybe your body, you felt like you were in your mind and not your body. So even as Jody was speaking, if you had any memories float up or any experiences, I want you guys to just bring that to mind for a minute and just let yourself remember that. Maybe engage all five senses. And if it helps, you can definitely close your eyes if that's comfortable. I invite you to do that. If not, feel free to keep them open. And just really bring your body back there for a minute. Maybe what the place felt like. Any smells you picked up on. Any sights or sounds. Just notice as you drop in, what did it feel like for you? Maybe some emotions are coming up. Maybe there's more than one. And as those surface, just notice what sensations are coming up. If I were to ask you to highlight this in one part of your body, where are you feeling it the most? Maybe it's in your chest and your chest feels heavy. Maybe it's your stomach and it feels like it's burning, or your shoulders feel really tight and piked up. And if it's uncomfortable sitting in that sensation, I ask you to just sit there for a few more seconds, knowing we're going to let that go. And if it's helpful, again, if those toddlers are starting to scream, that's where I invite you to just mentally whisper to yourself, I allow this, or this is just how it is right now. And as you do that, notice if you have an urge to do anything. Do you have an urge to curl up in a ball? Do you have an urge to get out and go somewhere safe? Maybe you have a lot of rage and you want to fight or be aggressive. Maybe you're feeling pulled towards eating something comfy, something nourishing, something sweet. And just notice if you have any patterns around anything that would feel soothing at this point. Maybe with caffeine, alcohol, some of those numbing things that we talked about, what feels soothing for you right now? Maybe it's even just getting under the blankets. And as you identify that, just notice what's happening to your energy. Are you feeling more drained? Maybe you feel more revved up in your system. Maybe you feel sleepy, or the opposite. It's hard for you to fall asleep when that happens. And now that we've felt that with our body, I want you to imagine a big TV screen as your brain. So it's that default mode network. And imagine it running a line through your head. And just notice, without nitpicking or judging, just observing, what is the statement that's running through your mind? If you were to finish the sentence, when I'm in this state, I believe that I am. Or I think that I am. It could be things like, I'm so helpless. I'm so foolish for thinking that. I'm so embarrassed. Or I am an embarrassment. I'm so weak and pathetic. And again, with that same TV screen on your mind, imagine it filling in the blank with this sentence. When I'm in this state, I believe the world is, or others around me are. It could be things like distant or unkind, out of reach, a burden. And now that you've acknowledged what those messages are and what happens to your body, just notice as you're hearing those messages, if you were to drop back in and highlight what that feels like when those messages come on, what is your body doing? Where are you feeling it? Where is it landing the most in your body? Maybe you feel it in your jaw and it's a little more clenched. Maybe your shoulders feel like they're carrying the weight of the world on your shoulders. Maybe all of a sudden you have this twitching and pain in your back. And I want you guys to just take a deep breath wherever you feel that. Just channel your breath into that area for a minute. And when you're ready, you can let go of that technique and just come back in. Can talk a little about through that and then go into our next activity. So that was just us walking through what it feels like to actually, when our mind has something going on, when it's harsh, when we went back and forth between our body, our mind, we noticed where our messaging was, how it affected our energy. Maybe some of you guys noticed, I remember when I did this activity for the first time, I noticed for me, I was running towards sugar. That was my comfort, or I was running towards isolating myself because people were just too much. They were unkind. They were the ones that were creating the problem, and it was more safe and comfortable for me to actually break relationship, because relationship was not always consistent. Or what if they hurt me even more when I'm hurting? And so that was a little bit of my process. But I want you guys to pinpoint what maybe you noticed in this exercise when it came to your energy, some of the self-soothing or some of the numbing. Where were your urges that you noticed? And what did it feel like to sit with your body instead of your mind? And did you have compassion for yourself, or did you judge yourself? Was that hard for you? And so another activity that we're going to do is kind of get you back into a safe place, bring you back to that awe. And then I want to make sure that you guys walk home with a tool, because I know we're doing something a little bit more robust, but I want to make sure that you guys have something in your hands to come home to that you can share with yourself, with others. And it's a tool that I keep practicing that you guys can keep growing in. And it's fun to either journal through when it feels like it's too much in our head. And with practice, it becomes second nature that we can practice with our bodies, of how to get out of our mind and back into our body, back into connection with ourselves, so that we can actually connect to God and connect to others, so that we can actually have capacity for relationships. And so the next activity we're going to do is going to be a feel-good one, where we kind of go the opposite, where we allow our bodies to feel when we're in that tender, soft inner critic or the automatic default mode. All right? So we want you guys to kind of go back to the breath. And again, you can either close your eyes if that feels comfortable, if that's been felt safe tonight, or just lower your gaze, focus on something, and maybe deepening your breath a little bit more, making it softer, longer. Allowing your body to soften with each breath. Maybe doing even a scan from the top of your head down to your toes. And if you land your attention on the area of your heart, imagine your breath as if it's flowing in and out of your heart or your chest area. And maybe deepening it or slowing it a little bit. Whatever feels comfortable for you. And this time, bring to mind something or someone that you appreciate, someone you care about, maybe a place that brings awe out of you, that feels safe and comfortable. It could be in nature. It could be someone's home or someone's arms. It could be imaginary if you want it to be. And allow yourself to really plant yourself in that space. Again, engaging all five senses, maybe imagining what it would feel like and look like to be there. If you're picking up any smells or tastes. And imagine with the next few breaths, just drinking it in a little bit deeper. And as you again drop into your body or notice what your body feels like in this moment, just pay attention to how different that feels. When you feel supported and comfortable and safe. Maybe notice what emotions are coming up for you, or even pinning it somewhere on your body. And again, taking a few breaths, slowly bringing yourself back to the room, back to this moment. When you're ready and when you're comfortable, go ahead and open your eyes, maybe shake your body out a little bit, wake it up, and just notice between those two exercises how different that felt. When you were in that automatic default mode and that harsh critic and where your body was at, and also when you were felt safe and connected, you had more capacity for yourself, and just the two different states. Did a lot of people feel a difference between those two? Yeah. Well, a tool that we can use to dip in between, because a lot of life is us going between two, and we can try to be in a place where, let's say, like the holidays, super excited to be with my family, with my partner's family. We've been planning about it for it for a couple of, you know, weeks now. And then it happens, and all of a sudden it's super overwhelming, and I'm an introvert, and I just need a little bit more alone time than I was expecting. And so we can plan for things, but our body's constantly jolted into different experiences. And so a tool that we can use, especially when we're living in our head, when there's anxiety, when we're stuck in that loop and it's hard to get out, is a little acronym that's called the RAIN technique. So it's R-A-I-N. And the first thing that we do is just recognize. And if any of you guys have toddlers or if you've worked with toddlers, this is a great analogy that I love to do with moms as well and walk them through, because it's just so easy to see a toddler and say this is exactly how what actually helps them as well. That's what regulates our nervous system. And it's usually very opposite to what we're doing, but it brings some of that compassion and care that we need so we can reconnect and finally have relationship and connection that we're all looking for. And so that first letter is just to recognize. That's a lot of what we did with some of our exercises, is recognizing what am I feeling and what am I sensing in my body. And so it's just identifying some of the emotions. So thinking about maybe something that you've been anxious about, or even going back to that first exercise that we did, whatever that messaging was, just noticing this is my emotions and this is the sensations. So we really try to go back to our body of where can I, if you even think of like pin the tail on the donkey, I like to kind of think of that with our body. Where can I pin this emotion? Where is it living on my body right now? Maybe I'm feeling it in my hips and they feel really tight and like constricted. Maybe I'm breathing really shallow and I just feel it in my chest. It's burning, it's hot, it's uncomfortable. And so learning to resource is the word that we use as our body. We kind of come back to our body that way with emotions and sensations. So that's the R for recognize. And then the next one is to acknowledge. And this is the number one step that people miss. And that's just to say, hey, this is okay. It's okay that you're feeling this. This is how it is right now. I know I'm going to be with you. It actually creates this space in our heart for us to hold space for ourselves. Like if you think of that toddler, you telling them right away what to do is not going to help. But when you actually, with a friend or a toddler, you sit with them and you make space and say, hey, I know you're struggling. I see that this emotion is coming up. I see how harsh you are with yourself right now. I see that this is hard. You're actually creating some of that space in your own nervous system. And so that's one of the most important things, and one of the things that's missed a lot is once you feel it in your body is actually just to sit with it. And sometimes that's where it gets uncomfortable and we want to run or numb, or we want to fight the emotion or suppress it. And there's a big temptation, and there's no judgment if you can't get it right. It takes a little bit of practice for our body to relearn some of this, because a lot of us who carry trauma, compassion seems very foreign. And this is that piece that reintegrates that compassion and reinvites compassion in. And so compassion is just, I love the word or the definition is compassion is with passion, sitting with passion towards yourself and towards others. And so acknowledging is, again, just letting yourself feel that for a minute. Instead of running to your mind or the next thing or how am I going to fix this? How am I going to get out of this? This is embarrassing. We sit with ourselves and acknowledge, this is really hard, or this is what I'm feeling right now, and that's okay. I'm going to give myself 2 more seconds. It doesn't have to be long. And so that's step number 2, is to acknowledge, and then we jump to investigate, and only then do we investigate. And that's when we allow ourselves to recognize, okay, this is what I'm feeling. This is what my body is sensing. I've sat with myself for a little bit. What is actually happening? And some questions that are good to ask is, what am I believing about myself and about others in this state? So when we did that first exercise, we did a little bit of a deeper format, but it's just coming back to what is actually the messaging that's running through my head. What am I believing about myself? What am I believing about the world and others? And that's where we start to investigate. This is the belief, and we call it out. And then we move to the third step. And just like with toddlers, when you scoop them up, they usually needed something. They didn't get something, and so now they're throwing a fit. And that's the same with a lot of our emotional needs, and that's where a lot of wounding and trauma happens, is it's on an emotional level. And so there's typically an unmet need that needs to come up. And we're not going to stop crying or throwing fits or being stuck in these loops until our need is met. And that's a beautiful way for us to, once we go through these steps, is to ask, what do I need in this moment? And maybe even feeling in your sensation, what does the sensation need? Maybe you need a hug. You thought you needed your friend to come back, but what you really need is just a hug. Or you need something soothing. Or maybe you do need some distance, because right now you and your spouse are trying to figure something out and it's too much and it's overwhelming. And what you really need is space, and it's hard for you to verbalize that. And you don't feel comfortable doing that. And so it's acknowledging the need of, this is what I need. And once we actually connect to the need, that's the beautiful part of when we can get to connect back to either filling that need with ourselves, inviting someone else to do that, or inviting God to fill that need. And just inviting Jesus into that space and saying, this is what I have, this is what I need. God's created us with needs. We're all needy. We all have deficits. We all have limitations. And I'm a firm believer that he's made us with needs so that he could fill them. And so this is a beautiful opportunity, once we actually connect to that need, for us to encounter God, to encounter others, to pull relationship in and close that loop for relationship instead of looping it in our head. And so again, the acronym is recognize, acknowledge, investigate, and then identify that need. And so you can journal through that. That's something that I typically do if I'm too in my head and I can't feel my body. And it's something that you can practice just intuitively as well as you get a little bit more comfortable. And just a side note with that one, it's really hard to do when you're starting out, when you're in this big state of you're stuck in your mind. And so something that might be helpful is even every few days going backwards when you're not in that state, when it's not so high and so loud, is to actually go back to an event and sit, you know, think about what happened last week, write it down, and go through that technique. Because again, our body actually uses that. It stores that information, and we get to rewire and rework and reintegrate our body into the experience. And so I'm going to invite Christine up to kind of acknowledge, how do we actually invite Jesus into the space once we actually connect to ourselves, and we can then connect to God and others.
Could we get some instrumental music on for this part? So this is the time to get to connect with God. And so I'm going to lead us through group ministry. Well, you'll be individually meeting with God, but as a group. So we'll turn some music on. And I welcome you to close your eyes, and I'll lead you through some things. If anything makes you uncomfortable or you feel disconnected from it, just stay connected to God, though, and keep talking to him. So I'm going to pray first. So Holy Spirit, I thank you that so much information was given that is important. But I pray that with it comes hope. That this isn't hopeless. You're a God that actually created us to have our brains heal. Our bodies get to heal. Our minds, our hearts get to heal. And so I pray that right now hope would rise up in people's hearts. And that in this time, it's a time to encounter you, God. Your goodness and your kindness. And so you can keep your eyes closed if you want while I go through a few things of connecting with him. And the first is hearing God over our lives and what he says to us. When I was younger, I had a really harsh inner critic, but not only was I hard on myself, I always thought God's voice was hard on me too. I thought that he really despised me and didn't love me or want to be with me. And a lot of that came from my own childhood. I didn't grow up with a father that was in the home, and there was just a lot of pain that happened. And so I grew up with a harsh voice for myself, but I also thought that was God's voice. And I remember I was in a ministry time kind of like this, and someone asked us to close our eyes and ask God, what does he think about us? And I pictured him looking a million miles in the sky down at me thinking, what a disappointment. And the person that was leading the time was like, I feel like God is saying to one of you that you think you're a disappointment, but you're not. And I remember that was the first time I even know that God interacted with us, really. And I was like, is this true that he actually might not think I'm a disappointment? And it was the beginning of something starting to unlock. And really, my healing came through understanding a very kind and loving God. And so we want to listen to the kindness tonight of what he's thinking about you. And so take a moment and ask him, what does he think about you? What is he thinking as he looks at you right now? And I promise you, his voice is kind. And if it's anything other than that, take a moment and say, Holy Spirit, I want to hear what you are really saying. And it might be hard to receive sometimes the kindness of what he's speaking over us. So just notice what he's saying. And Lord, I ask that whatever it is you're speaking over them would begin to take new life in them. To know that they are incredibly valued, seen, and known. And then take a moment to think about what it was. Maybe it was something that came up when Ellie was speaking about what the harsh phrase might be. But what is their harsh phrase or word that you've been believing about yourself? And as it's coming to mind, tell it to God. Tell him how painful it is to be carrying that. And it might be hard because there's a lot of us that have a hard time learning new truths about us. But even you just quietly do this, say, in the name of Jesus Christ, I choose to break partnership with this lie. And invite the Holy Spirit to tell you what does he say in place of that lie over you. And Holy Spirit, I ask that these truths would begin to take root in life. If any of you are struggling in hearing a truth, the phrase that's been coming to my mind a lot tonight over you are our son and daughter. And so, Holy Spirit, I pray that you would show people what that means to actually belong to you. For me, being a daughter was incredibly painful because it just meant rejection. It just meant not wanting to be with me. And so it had a lot of pain. But when I started to understand the love of God, it actually began to become something beautiful. And so, Lord, I pray that something beautiful would begin to be birthed in everybody's hearts about what it means to actually belong to you. And now we're going to take another aspect of what Ellie was doing earlier and finding a place, like what Jody was saying, like in her pictures, a place of awe. And so I want you all to think of a place that you love so much or that you would love to be. When I'm doing this, I often picture myself in a forest sitting at a campfire, or I'm in the mountains, or I'm sitting in a barn overlooking the field. So think of a place, even if you haven't been there, or maybe it is a place you've been, a place that you feel safe in and that you love being in. And as you see this place, step into it. Picture yourself walking around. Look down at your feet. Notice the ground that you're standing on. Feel what the weather is like in this place. Notice what you're feeling in this place. And invite God to come into it with you. Find a place to sit with Him or to walk with Him. Notice how you feel with Him. I'm just going to give you a minute to spend time with Him in this place, to listen to what it is that He wants to say to you, what He wants to show you, or maybe what you want to say to Him. If any of you are struggling with what to say or what to do in this place, or even struggling seeing anything, there's no shame in that. But welcome His love to meet with you. Let the love of God meet with you. And let the love of God meet with you in some of the most painful places that you carry. Sometimes those are the last places we want Him in because there's shame and there's pain, but that's the very place we need a Savior. So invite Him into that place. We'll do this for about 30 more seconds before we pray through a few more things. What I love about this is a place that you can go. This is where I go for prayer time so often because I might be traveling or just in a really hard time where I can't just get away to the wilderness, but God has given us this place in our minds that we can actually see trees and water and mountains. And I have friends that are missionaries in the Middle East, and they're like, when I just close my eyes and I envision rivers and lakes, and I just sit by Jesus at a lake and a river because they're in the desert, but they long for that place and they can just close their eyes and be there with God. And there's something really powerful about that. So I recommend even at night as you're going to bed, just sit in this place with Him and see what He wants to speak over you. So just a few more things and then we'll close it out. So Holy Spirit, I pray that as we move into this next part, that You would continue to meet with every person in this room. reminding them that you are a God of hope and healing. And one of the things that was coming to mind was some of you might have hurt and anger towards God. And that can be really hard and painful when you know that that's who you want to meet with and who's a healer, but you also are really hurt and unsure why things have happened, why certain situations went the way they did. And I remember I had so much anger at God and I just couldn't even talk to him. I was so mad. And one time I'd close my eyes doing kind of what we had just done. And I was sitting on a porch in this anger and I could see that God was sitting next to me, but my back was turned to him and he just tapped me on my shoulder. And I turned around and he said, "You can be angry, but be angry at me with me." And so what I'm just saying, what I want to lead you through is a time of inviting him into any anger or hurt you had towards him. This doesn't mean it all goes away, but it means, okay, God, I want to wrestle through this with you now, not on my own. I want to understand you in the midst of these questions. So Holy Spirit, I pray for anyone that's in this place of struggling with you, with whether or not you're actually safe. Anyone that has anger and fear towards you, that they would know you, however that might be in this journey. And so I pray, Lord, that you would meet with them in that place of pain and of suffering. And so just take a moment quietly, if you're willing to invite him into your anger or your pain or your sadness. And God is incredibly kind. And I feel like he's wanting me to even remind you that his tone is very gentle towards you. Even if you're mad, you're not fully ready to be super close to him. He is so patient and kind. And so, Lord, I pray that your kindness would continue to flow over every single person in this room. That if anyone hears a harsh tone from you, that it would actually become gentle. That they would begin to really hear you and the tone of your voice towards them. That it is different from some of our parents. It's different from the way maybe our siblings or friends have spoken over us. And Holy Spirit, I pray with everything that you've been pouring out tonight, that there would be an understanding of your closeness to them. As Jody was speaking about that alarmed aloneness, I pray that you would minister into any aloneness, that if people are struggling connecting to other humans right now, they would actually have an incredibly deep connect with you. God, that you would begin healing their hearts. And there's just one more thing I want to pray over you, something I'm really passionate about and love, and so is Jody and Ellie, is raising up communities to minister and heal each other. I do a course on this where we train our communities, how do we care for each other? And there's something really, really powerful about this community right here that's really sweet. And I think there's something in this for you, and I want to pray this for you. So Holy Spirit, I pray over this community, that they would be known as the ones that can minister and heal the people around them through you, through your spirit, that people would walk into this place knowing that it's safe. And so I pray an equipping of every single person, that you would continue to not only heal their hearts, but raise them up as ambassadors of love. I pray an incredible sharp discernment over this group. Kingdom wisdom and understanding for the hearts of man. The way to get to the heart of man is from the heart of the Father. And so I pray that through all of this, this is a church that would be wrecked by the Father's love in the most beautiful way. And so we pray a blessing over this place and the work that you're doing, God. We just ask for more for everyone in this room, everyone a part of this church, more for them, God. Yeah, in your name we pray. Amen. Amen. All right, so I'll pass this off right over here.
There's a verse that where in the scripture that talks about the same comfort that you have been given, you'll comfort other people. And it just comes to my mind as we were finishing up in prayer, and I appreciate the prayer for our body, because this is a place where you can come, because people have been comforted. I've been comforted. God has healed me in so many ways. I've seen John walk through that and be honest with what's going on in his life, and he's been comforted so he can comfort other people. And I look through the crowd here of so many people that are here, and God has comforted you in so many ways so that you can minister to the rest of the body in our community. And so today, if you're here and you're like, I need to be a part of a community that loves me, that loves God, that's part of my healing, this is it. And I want to tell you that our Celebrate Recovery brothers and sisters are all wearing their shirts today because they have been comforted, and they want to help you through things too. So if you're struggling in any of those ways, it's a great place to join in on Friday nights. But I want to invite you tonight that if you want prayer, if you want to talk to one of these ladies, if you want to talk to Pastor John's going to hang out, I'm going to hang out. If you want to talk to one of our red-shirted Celebrate Recovery people and get some personal ministry, there's time for that today. But if you need to be in community, I want you to do that, and I want to help you do that. And so stop out the Connection Center. Talk to Amy, who's going to be out there. She'll help you with some of those things. But I want to just thank you guys for being here, and thank you so much. I cannot pray a more beautiful prayer than you just did today. Now. So you guys we're going to dismiss you, but I want to leave the music going and just leave this space in here. So if you want to talk and you want to visit, please do that. But let's take that outside of here. And anybody who needs time to just sit more with God, because we don't do a lot of that. And that was somewhat uncomfortable sometimes, wasn't it? To just sit with God for a little longer than we're used to. But I want to invite you to stay here if you need to sit with God longer. And I want to invite you to be able to come forward and just talk to anybody that you need to talk to today if you need that comfort from somebody else today. Thank you for coming, guys.